are turning our scripture reading to Revelation, the 7th chapter, and we begin from verse 9 to 17. After this, I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of water of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Let us pray. O God, we come into your presence, standing with the saints of old and the saints that are around us. Be with us as we seek your presence and your love, and bless us with our ability to draw closer to you. And may the word of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. A minister, a priest, and a rabbi went out fishing in a small boat. But when they got to the middle of the lake, the rabbi realized that he did not have his fishing rod. So he got out of the boat and walked on the water back to the shore. A couple of minutes later, the priest beeper went off, and he needed to get back to shore to make a phone call. You can tell it's an old, old story, right? And so he got out of the boat, and just like the rabbi, walked on water to the shore. So the minister sitting in the boat goes, "You know, I have as much faith, if not more, than the rabbi and the priest. I know my faith will help me to walk on water as well." So as soon as the minister got out of the boat, he began to sink. And so he pulled himself back up into the boat and tried again. Again, he sinks right to the bottom of the lake. So he gets up again onto the surface, and he's trying to get on the boat, and he does get on the boat, and the priest finally tells the rabbi, "We better tell him where the rocks are before he drowns." This morning, we are celebrating All Saints Sunday while remembering those who have shown us where the rocks are, so that we can stand and not drown. It is about remembering those Christians who have gone before us, who have shown us what it means to walk in the way of Jesus the Christ, the solid rock. This is the day when we remember all those who have, one way or another, helped us to stand and remain standing even the most difficult and trying times of our faith. And in today's scripture, we find a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from every tribe, and people from all languages standing before the throne. We can take the earlier story with humor, but there is nothing lighthearted about this story in Revelation. The last book of the Bible was written for a church that was experiencing unbearable persecution. The book looks evil, full in the face, facing a chaotic world that includes flying horses, lots of blood, a lake of fire, and plenty of noisy trumpets that did not sound like the choir, because these noisy trumpets would have been blaring sirens to the people that were hearing from this letter. Because it reminded them of the chaotic world in which they lived. Our portion of the scripture is found between the sixth seal and the seventh seal. Each of the previous six seals revealed destruction, devastation, and death. They had gone through a time of tribulation, and when we are about to be overloaded with all the terror, we get a break. The picture changes. Now we see four angels who stand at the four corners of the earth, holding back destructive winds. And we are given an image of what Barbara Rosing wrote, Salvation Interlude, a break that brings salvation. Lord God, the Good Shepherd, provides shelter over this multitude. And the Greek word that is used for shelter is skenosoi, which gives the imagery of God dwelling and sheltering us as a canopy over us from the destructive forces. A break that delivers a message of hope. People from all nations standing and worshiping around the throne of God. Instead of bloodshed, we see a multitude wearing white robes. Instead of the cacophony of blaring trumpets, we hear singing rising to the throne of God. A great multitude from all tribes and peoples singing in their own tongues. This picture underscores the multi-ethnic character of the people of God. John, the author of Revelation, who is banished to the island of Patmos, may have been a recent refugee to Asia Minor from Palestine following the war between the Jews and the Romans. According to Gusto Gonzalez, author of For the Healing of the Nations, the Book of Revelation in an Age of Cultural Conflict, John's dual identity as a Jew writing to Greek-speaking people in Asia Minor in a land and language foreign to John describes people Gonzalez coined as hybrid identities. And he writes, the mestizo is at home in two places and is not quiet at home in either. I've always loved this passage. For me, who has felt out of place growing up in culturally different countries, this text makes me feel at home. I'm at home with this text, and I hope you all do too. Leaving Korea when I was 6 years old to a country where clearly I was a minority, I was on the receiving end of kids poking fun at my Asian features. Parents being critical because I was not accustomed to their culture in Argentina. I was often out of place, not knowing how to be around completely different cultures, language, and practices. And then by the time I was accustomed to the Argentinian way, my family came to America, and I had to start all over again, finding myself again out of context with what was customary for me. So in a way, I lived with hybrid identities, as Justo Gonzalez described, almost all of my life. I often think that I was born in Korea, raised in Argentina, naturalized in the United States of America, but I never really truly felt at home anywhere. So my permanent address is standing with the saints in heaven and here. Hybrid identities. But then again, don't we all live hybrid identities if you're really honest to yourselves? We don't always feel like we fit in, do we? I know that when I visited Korea a few years ago, I felt out of place, even in my native country. I looked Korean. I spoke and understood Korean. I eat Korean food, best food in the world. I love Korean dramas, but I still felt out of place. And you know what I found most interesting? Is that the Koreans in Korea could tell that I was not from Korea. There's even a word in Korea, gyopo, which identifies those who look Korean but are not Korean. That's me. Friends, we are all one way or another living hybrid identities, which is not always bad, but in many ways, we are each at home in two places. It is not quiet at home in neither. We may not quite fit in because of our differing identities, social economic status, and political views. And I can go on and on. That is why teenagers deal with peer pressure, and adults trying to keep up with the Joneses. But here in the seventh chapter of Revelation, we are invited to be at home and accept it just the way we are. We are all singing in our preferred tongues, and no one is casting an evil eye because we do that. We are all worshiping together, and no one cares about your ethnicity. We are all standing together, and no one cares if the person next to you looks like you or not, or believes the way you do or not. This image is what I envision every time we come together and pray the Lord's Prayer, the part that goes, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done." Bring this kingdom that John saw and make it real here on earth. It's a replicate representation of what we see happening, the saints standing with one another, with a cord, and singing around the throne of God. And to do that, we have the vision that John saw. And we do that by three simple rules that I shared with the children. Do no harm. And not just don't do harm, because that's just half the equation, you know? Do good. Not just do not do any harm, But you got to do the other part of the coin, the other side of the coin, which is do good. And we can do both of those by staying in love with God. Three simple rules. Bring this kingdom, and to make it real here on earth, we are to stand with the saints that are among us without halos and the saints who have gone ahead of us. And when we do that, we will all find ourselves at home, for no one will feel out of place. And we need to stand with all the saints, because this work of bringing the kingdom of God here on earth is not a lone, solitary job. According to Deborah Dean Murphy's blog, Saints in the Plural, we do not see the word saint, S-A-I-N-T, in the singular in the New Testament. There are only saints in the plural. In the New Testament, it only exists in the plural. I think that is so comforting to know that we don't have to do the work on becoming saints all by ourselves, that we are standing with the saints around us who both bug us and bless us, and those who we remember in our hearts, so that we can also help each other make ourselves at home, living out the life of sainthood by doing no harm, doing good, and staying in love with God. It will also be a witness to our children, grandchildren, and the rest of the people that we deal with. We are all in the saints making business. Once I remember, I did a baptism of a baby, one of my favorite things to do, and the little girl had 18 godparents. 18 godparents. They all got onto the chancel area, and I'm looking around, and they range from age 17 to 89. 18 godparents. And I jokingly said, well, this little girl is in trouble. She's going to have all these people keeping an eye on her. She will not be able to do any wrong. So later on during the reception, I spoke to the mother, and she shared a reason why she had so many and why they were all godparents of different generations. She said, as one generation moves on to stand with the saints in heaven, there will be others who will continue to stand around for her daughter. 17 to 89. You and I are baptized children of God who have the responsibility of being accountable to one another, as well as being the godparents to all those who are entrusted to us. Sainthood is not achieved after we pass on from this earth. Sainthood is achieved in the actions and deeds of our lives. Do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. And as we remember those who have encouraged us and cheered us on, we are to live our lives in such a way that we might show the love of God in Jesus the Christ to others, just as the ones that we named showed that love to us. On All Saints Sunday, this is a time that we receive encouragement as we remember those who have passed from last year. And as we lifted up their names, we remember them again. Harry Harris, Herb Hensel, Peggy Verhees, Vern Miller, Vic Stolle, Gloria Wallman, and all those that you have named. But at the same time, we also continue to celebrate and give thanks for the lives of those who are around us. Yes, those that bug us, as well as those that bless us. For being a saint is something that Jesus invites all of us to do. So look around you. I'm not going to ask you to linger with eye contact, all that stuff, but just look around you in general. Look around you. They're standing in our midst, well, at least sitting down in our midst, are those who are here to make us saints. And we are also responsible in our deeds and words and actions and prayers and presence to help them become saints. For all of you and all of those who have gone ahead of us have shown us where the rocks are so that we don't drown. We are standing among all the saints, and I pray that we may be able to stand together, hand in hand, loving each other, caring for one another, remembering those who passed, and remembering that we are being watched, that we have all these godparents among us to help us to do no harm, do good, and stay in love with God. Amen.